Well, thank you very much, Ro, for that very generous introduction. And of course, I want to thank Dr. Ken Ford, director of the IHMC here, for the invitation to speak. I assume most of you know he has a very special multidisciplinary group here that includes a host of very smart people trying to solve complex problems. So I think Ken is someone I very much admire and a bit jealous of the culture and infrastructure he has here to do some very neat research. I also think Ken's a very cool guy, and I didn't realize how cool he was until he mentioned this afternoon he has a fascination of 4 GTs. And if you don't know, the 4 GT is a pretty iconic supercar that Ford developed in the 60s to beat Ferrari at the 24-hour Le Mans. And I think it's relevant to what he's done here. You know, that was a true example of an American company bringing together all its resources to build a technologically advanced car that literally beat the pants off Ferrari. And I think you know, that's something we need to inspire more in academia, is this concept of team research and accomplishing big goals. So Ken, if you ever need a personal chauffeur, if you buy that Ford GT, I'll come down here in a heartbeat. So there's only one topic I enjoy talking more about than the Ford GT, and that's ketogenic diets. So on that note, I've been more or less obsessed with studying how humans respond to restricting carbohydrates for the last 15 years or so. And the truth is, it's a bit more complex than I initially thought. But we have learned a lot, and we're wrapping up a remarkable decade of research on low carbohydrate diets. And so I just want to give you a little flavor of that in today's lecture over the next 45 minutes or so. Let's see. Here we go. So my sort of approach this evening is to discuss three major themes here. First of all, I want to provide a little overview from a metabolic perspective on this concept of freeing yourself from carbohydrate addiction. Because in many ways, I'll hope to convince you that when you eat carbs, that more or less locks you into a dependence on carbohydrate as a fuel source. And so freeing people from this carbohydrate addiction is really a fundamental step in moving them toward better health. And then I want to sort of dispel some common myths about ketosis and this idea of keto adaptation, and discuss some of the implications of being in a ketotic state on health and even peak performance. And then finally, since at the end of the day, most people just want to know, what do I eat? I want to spend some time on what constitutes a well-formulated ketogenic diet. There's a lot of casual approaches to restricting carbohydrate, and not all of those approaches may be effective or even safe, and definitely not sustainable. So there are some issues that you really need to understand in terms of actually putting together and constructing a diet that's restricted in carbs, that's healthy and sustainable. So if we look at basic metabolism, you really have two fuel sources your body can use for energy, and those are carbohydrate and fat. And in terms of carbohydrate, we did not evolve to store much carbohydrate in our body. We can put away about 2,000 kilocalories worth of fuel in the form of glycogen as far as our carbohydrate fuel tank. And that's primarily in skeletal muscle as well as a little bit in the liver. So that's enough to, you know, if you're exercising, that may last a couple hours, and then suddenly you're out of fuel. And that's what hitting the wall or bonking is. Now, contrast that to our ability to store fat. We have a remarkable level of ability to enhance our capacity to store fat. On average, we could store 2,000 kcals worth of fat. Even in a lean person, we can store well over tenfold greater amounts of energy in fat. If you happen to be a little overweight, it may be more like 20 or 50-fold more. So if you're overweight and if you're obese, it's really this fuel tank that you want to access for fuel. And this concept of eating carbs, locking you into a dependence on carbs, really manifests itself in this sort of manner that if you can't oxidize the carbs that you're eating, and this is a problem if you're overweight or obese, and you can't store it because your stores are full, there's only one other option, and that's the carbs get converted to fat. And that does happen in many individuals who are overweight and obese. So here's what happens if you eat carbohydrate. Your body digests and absorbs that carbohydrate as glucose primarily, and so you'll see an elevation in blood sugar. And this spike in blood sugar is followed by an increase in insulin levels in the body, and that drives the blood sugar into cells. And that often results in a subsequent rebound low blood sugar. And we tend to focus a lot on this because this is what you feel when you're tired after lunch and you want to put your head down and you're hungry and you want to seek out some additional carbohydrates. But the other sort of insidious effect here that occurs because of the insulin response is that you block access to your fat stores. So eating carbohydrates and increasing your insulin level essentially blocks your ability to mobilize and burn body fat. And just to give you a sense of the physiology here, here is a graph of insulin levels versus fat breakdown. And this could just as well be fat oxidation. So you see, first of all, this relationship's not linear. It's very curvilinear, such that small changes in insulin result in large changes in fat breakdown and fat burning. So this is the difference between eating, you know, some carbohydrate at lunch versus not consuming carbohydrate. And you're subsequently either in a state where you're not burning fat if you're eating carbs, or if you avoid carbs or limit them, you can be in a much higher fat burning state. So yeah, promise I won't go too far here into metabolism, but I think it's important and helpful to understand what happens when you eat just a single meal of carbohydrates. So first of all, we don't have much glucose in our blood. The total amount of glucose is equivalent to maybe 1 or 2 teaspoons. You may be ingesting in a normal carbohydrate meal 10 times that. And so the body has to deal with that and get rid of that incoming glucose. And if you're healthy, most of that incoming carbohydrate is taken up by skeletal muscle, where it's either converted to glycogen temporarily and then burned as fuel and oxidized. But we now know that in people who have some level of insulin resistance, so if you're obese, if you're type 2 diabetic, or you have metabolic syndrome, a greater proportion of that incoming dietary carbohydrate gets diverted to the liver, where it's converted to fat in a process called de novo lipogenesis. So this is sort of a secondary or alternative pathway for carbohydrate to take. And in the liver, you actually make a saturated fat that gets packaged into a VLDL particle and actually gets released into the blood. So in people who have insulin resistance, you can actually see several hours after eating carbohydrate that fat levels go up in the blood. And this is really not a benign situation. There's a lot of sort of collateral damage that can occur as a result of this processing of carbs through this pathway. And a way to view this functionally is as a form of carbohydrate intolerance. If you're diverting carbs to this pathway, you're essentially carbohydrate intolerant, and that's putting you on a fast track toward type 2 diabetes. So in many ways, what you can do with diet is you can switch your metabolism from a carb-based metabolism where you're relying on glucose for fuel to one that's almost exclusively based on fatty acids and ketones as your primary fuel sources. And we're starting to really learn a lot about the metabolic and health benefits of switching cellular metabolism to a fat-based type of metabolism. In fact, this is, you know, over 98% of human history, we evolved in the context of primarily a fat-burning metabolism. It's only the last 10,000 years that we've had agricultural carbohydrates and even a much shorter time period for certain cultures. And we're starting to learn that, you know, switching a cell to burning fat is associated with less free radicals, less reactive oxygen species, and generally a more healthy type of metabolic state. And so this sort of, in a general sense, brings up this idea of fat and ketones as preferred or premium fuel, and how this might promote better health, better performance, and better recovery. And this has really been my interest over the years in studying how this affects various diseases, from type 2 diabetes and metabolic syndrome, all the way to the other end of the spectrum, where I'll show you data today how switching over to fat burning is helping athletes, not just your average recreational athletes, but elite world-class athletes. So to kind of give you some evidence and data on the fact that carbohydrates drive fat metabolism, this is data from a controlled feeding experiment that we recently completed, where we literally fed people all their food for 5.5 months. Every 3 weeks they switched diets, and you can see we initially dropped their carbs down to very low levels and then progressively increased their carbs. And what you see here, this is respiratory exchange ratio. The lower the value here, the greater the fat burning. So you see right off the bat, you see when we restrict carbs, fat oxidation increases. As we reintroduce carbs, you see decreases in fat oxidation in a pretty linear manner here. So the point being, carbohydrate intake strongly related to the level of fat burning. So I want to spend a little bit of time talking to you about ketones. Ketones in general are widely misunderstood, even among people in the healthcare industry and physicians, and even many researchers studying diet, partly because ketones were originally discovered in uncontrolled type 1 diabetics, where they produce ketones uncontrollably and you end up with ketoacidosis. But when you have ketones in a more moderate range, and when they're induced by restricting carbohydrates, you have a very different scenario. So I want to just make sure you understand a few terms here. First of all, ketosis, this is sort of a simple definition. Ketones are small metabolites that are produced in the liver, so they're hepatically derived, that can provide fuel to nearly every cell outside of the liver. Nutritional ketosis is the process of inducing ketosis by restricting carbohydrates. And it also occurs when you're in a starvation mode, because you're also limiting carbohydrates in that mode. So you have starvational as well as nutritional ketosis. In contrast, ketoacidosis is a dangerous side effect when you have insufficient insulin. So a type 1 diabetic who does not produce insulin will have sort of this unregulated increase in ketones that can become problematic. But in a non-type 1 diabetic, that virtually never happens. And then this term keto-adaptation essentially refers to the process of shifting your metabolism over to burning fatty acids and ketones as a fuel source over a period of several weeks. So in essence, being in nutritional ketosis for an extended period of time. So here's just a little cartoon to kind of give you a better sense of what's happening. So when you're breaking down fat at a very high rate in your fat cells, so you're breaking down triglycerides into fatty acids, those fatty acids enter into the blood and are transported to the liver. And in the liver, when fatty acids are delivered at such a high rate, they can't be completely oxidized, the body essentially turns them into ketones. So the process of ketogenesis. And the two primary ketone bodies are beta-hydroxybutyrate and acetoacetate. And so you can kind of see here, these are byproducts of fatty acid metabolism. So in essence, the fatty acids are just being converted to ketones and then transported back to the blood, where they can then be transported to other cells for fuel. So it's a sort of a temporary way to provide energy in the form of fat. And primarily, ketones have been studied in the context of their displacement of glucose in the brain for fuel. So when you don't have carbohydrate available, these ketones can now displace glucose as a fuel in the brain. And this is a really important adaptation and benefit that allows humans to survive during long periods of starvation, where you can essentially provide fuel for the brain, whereas normally the brain is dependent on glucose. And you've probably heard this before, that many experts will tell you the brain is a glucose-dependent organ. You've got to have carbs for the brain. And normally that's true if you're eating carbohydrate and you're preventing ketosis. So 100% of the glucose is normally, 100% of the brain's energy needs are met by glucose in a fed state in a person normally eating carbohydrate. But in prolonged starvation or in prolonged carbohydrate restriction where you're producing ketones, you can have 2/3 of the energy coming from ketones. So clearly the brain's energy needs can be met primarily from substances other than glucose, in this case ketones. So even when you're not eating, you can have a perfectly well-fed brain because of ketones. And I'll come back to why that might be important, but this is some really, spectacular data here that actually was never published. It was buried in a review paper, I think because it would be impossible to get IRB approval to do this now anyway. But this was work done by George Cahill back in the 60s when they were studying starvation ketosis. What they did was they took a group of healthy individuals who had been starved for several weeks so that they were producing ketones. You see now, I'll talk to you about the levels here, but this is very high levels, above 5 millimolar beta-hydroxybutyrate. And then what they decided to do was infuse insulin into these folks. And by infusing insulin, that drove their normal fasting blood sugar levels at 70 milligrams per deciliter down to 25 milligrams per deciliter. Now, to put that into perspective, in anyone in this room who's not in ketosis, if you had a blood sugar of 25, you'd be on the floor, most likely in a coma. Yet these people had absolutely no signs or symptoms of low blood sugar or hypoglycemia. So in essence, being in a state of ketosis makes you bonk-proof. Makes you not susceptible to hitting the wall. So that's why athletes are doing this, and I'll come back to that. But you know, it's not just athletes that hit the wall. I mean, you could be sedentary and just be carb intolerant and you eat a high carb meal and you want to take a nap after that. That's your brain in a fuel crisis. That's sort of hitting the wall. So being keto adapted, one of the most profound benefits is just having this sustained fuel source for the brain. So here's the main difference between ketosis, nutritional ketosis, and ketoacidosis. It's one of magnitude. So if you're eating a normal carbohydrate diet and you measure somebody's ketones, they're less than 0.1 millimole per liter. Now, if you eat a very low carbohydrate diet and measure ketones, or I'm sorry, if you're eating a moderate carbohydrate diet but just measure ketones after an overnight fast, they start to go up a little bit, maybe up to 0.3. If you fast for several weeks without any food, they can go up to 5 to 7 millimolar. A very low carbohydrate diet, and this varies from person to person, but in general, less than 50 grams a day, would generally put most people between 0.5 and 3 millimolar. Now, there is a well-known phenomenon of post-exercise ketosis, so you could bump that up even a little further right after exercise. But contrast that to the levels seen in ketoacidosis, which you will never reach if you're restricting carbs and you're not a type 1 diabetic. So we're talking about an order of magnitude different from the normal carbohydrate-fed state to a carbohydrate-restricted state. But we're a whole order of magnitude lower than what you see in ketoacidosis. So this is really important in terms of understanding why this is not dangerous. This is not associated with acidosis or any change in pH in the blood. So here's just another sort of figure to show you the differences here in nutritional ketosis being in the green here. Probably starting at about 0.5, extending up to 3, 4 millimolar, but ketoacidosis is way over here. And it's probably in this range where you have optimal fuel flow, optimal inter-organ fuel exchange, and it's quite an elegant system the body has developed and evolved over millions of years that allows this perfect metabolic exchange of fuels. So I would argue, and I'll provide you some additional evidence, that being in a state of ketosis offers a lot of benefits for people, and especially for some people that might have insulin resistance and type 2 diabetes. But you might ask, how do you know if you're in ketosis? Are there ways to measure this? And the answer is yes. By far the most common method is to measure ketones in the urine. So you have a little sort of strip here that you run your urine stream through, and if it changes color, you're in varying levels of ketosis. But after you've been on a ketogenic diet for several weeks, turns out the kidneys go through some very important adaptations where they tend to reabsorb more of the ketones. So I find urine to not be a very active or accurate method, and can sometimes provide confusing and discouraging results. In other words, you can be in ketosis but not be registering ketones in your urine. So by far a more accurate and preferred method of measuring this is actually determining it in blood. And you can do this quite easily with a couple companies offer a handheld glucometer about the size of this device here that can measure beta-hydroxybutyrate. And they're very accurate. And it's just done with a finger stick. And it's if you're patient enough to wait 5 seconds, you actually get a value that tells you you're in ketosis. And I find this is very empowering and informative for people, because many people will find they think they're in ketosis, but they're really not. And so it can help you fine-tune the diet to find that right mix of foods that allows you to be in the right range. And then on the horizon, are methods to determine breath acetone, which is another ketone body or breakdown product of ketones that's volatile and gets expired in the breath. And it does correlate very highly with blood levels, so I do think this has some merit, and there are several companies that are very close to having commercially available products that that would provide a truly non-invasive way to monitor ketones, whereas you do have to sort of stick your finger here. So here's some of the science of ketones. Most of the research up until the last few years has really focused on ketones as an alternative fuel source for the brain and other tissues. And there's been some very nice work documenting the sort of the biochemical and metabolic effects of burning ketones. So when the mitochondria is using ketones, they're generating less reactive oxygen species. And that's really, you know, that's really profound. Because in many ways you could interpret that as ketones are a cleaner burning fuel. There's less exhaust and damaging effects of metabolizing ketones than glucose and other substrates like lactate and pyruvate and even fatty acids. And some isolated work in the heart has shown you get more work per unit ATP when you're burning ketones versus other substrates, so there's greater efficiency. And this is, again, very, I think, important, and whether or not this plays out at the systemic level in humans, I don't think we have that data yet. But I think even more provocative is some recent data suggesting that ketones, beyond their role as fuel, are actually signals, that they're signaling various pathways and affecting gene expression. So in other words, they're acting as epigenetic modulators of gene expression, in particular controlling expression of genes related to oxidative stress and antioxidant defense. And this was really laid out in a recent paper by Eric Verdun, his group out at the Gladstone Institute, showing that in animals who were made ketotic through various protocols, including diet, and they even implanted a ketone pump to elevate ketones in these animals, but they showed these effects of ketones on protection from oxidative stress. And of course they worked out the mechanism. This was a paper published in Science, as affecting histone deacetylase. So they're histone deacetylase inhibitors. And this is a very dynamic area of study right now. In fact, every pharmaceutical company is testing various drugs on their ability to inhibit histone deacetylases. And I think if any of them come up with a drug that has the same effect of ketones, it would be a blockbuster. So we're really looking at a nutritional manipulation that can elevate a metabolite that has drug-like effects. So a lot of the focus of very low carbohydrate ketogenic diets have been on weight loss, and clearly that data shows some very promising effects. That ketogenic diets can really be beneficial for managing weight. But to me, that's really the tip of the iceberg. More importantly, ketogenic diets have therapeutic effects. And most, I think, obvious is its effects on diabetes and metabolic syndrome or pre-diabetes. But also you're seeing a lot of interest now in other chronic diseases that in many ways are related to oxidative stress and inflammation, like cancer and other neurological disorders. But I want to talk to you a little bit about diabetes, in particular type 2 diabetes, because the effects are nothing short of remarkable in that population. So just to not sort of burden you with going over a lot of individual studies, I just wanted to show you, these are a couple meta-analyses that were published in the last couple years. In fact, coming to the conclusion that low carbohydrate diets are better than low fat diets at inducing weight loss, but also beyond weight loss, improving cardiovascular risk factors. And in particular, I've been interested in studying the pre-diabetic condition, and this was a randomized study where we had people consume either a very low carbohydrate ketogenic diet or a traditional low fat diet for 12 weeks. And we measured everything under the sun that we could figure out how to analyze. And I'm just showing you some of the variables here. But in almost every case, a low carbohydrate diet wins. So lipids get better. In particular, triglycerides, HDL increases, the good cholesterol. The quality of the LDL improves. Glucose, insulin, insulin sensitivity, leptin levels all improve to a greater extent. In particular, I've had an interest in studying saturated fat metabolism, and we actually see saturated fat levels go down more on a well-formulated low-carbohydrate diet. And I'll come back to that a little more later. But we get across-the-board improvements in standard as well as emerging risk factors with ketogenic diets. So type 2 diabetes, this is an area that I'm really focused on at the moment, because type 2 diabetes is a huge problem. We have not just an epidemic in the United States, but this is a real global problem. But in the US, we've got about 10% of the population has type 2 diabetes. And this is an enormous burden on our health care system. I mean, the average additional health cost associated with treating a type 2 diabetic is about $8,000 a year. So about one in five healthcare dollars, or $200 billion, is spent managing type 2 diabetes. And the, you know, the sort of sad news here is that things are getting worse, that current treatments are failing. So we're expected to be spending $500 million or $500 billion by 2020, and rates will be upwards of 15-20% of the population will have type 2 diabetes. And the current treatment is basically a low-fat diet, high in carbohydrates, plus drugs. And that's, if anything, exacerbating the problem and making pharmaceutical companies more wealthy. And it's just insanity, really. These are the educational materials from the American Diabetes Association and American Dietetic Association, I think it's called something different now. And what do you see here? This is a lot of carbohydrate. We've got the jelly beans here that diabetics need to have. I guess that's appropriate. Seeing Easter was last week. But really, come on. We're promoting a diet that requires, you know, you take more medication. So it's really mind-boggling. But here's what can happen if you put diabetics on the right diet. So these are really well-controlled studies. This goes back almost 20 years ago now, where Barry Gumbiner showed in obese type 2 diabetics, these are just really short-term diets, well-controlled though, where he fed these type 2 diabetics a very low-calorie diet, 650 kcals, that were equal in protein. But one was very low in carbs, and the other one contained enough carbs where they weren't in ketosis. So you see on the very low carb, low calorie, they were in nutritional ketosis, about 3 millimolar, compared to the non-ketotic but low calorie diet. And what they showed was it was the ketogenic diet, the one low in carbohydrate, that resulted in the most profound improvements in fasting blood sugar as well as postprandial blood sugar. And they showed a 22% decrease in hepatic glucose output. That's the fundamental problem in type 2 diabetes, is their livers produce too much glucose, and that raises their blood sugar. They may also be insulin resistant in skeletal muscle. But very interestingly here, they showed a strong correlation between the level of ketones in their blood and the reduction in hepatic glucose output, suggesting ketones were really a mediator of this benefit. But it also shows just weight loss itself and decreasing your caloric intake is not optimizing the condition. You have to consider the quality of the nutrients, in this case, restricting the carbs to a level that induced ketosis. Here's another inpatient, well-controlled metabolic ward study where obese type 2 diabetics were fed a very low carbohydrate diet for 2 weeks, and you see remarkable reductions in plasma glucose and plasma insulin levels in the open circles here. Hemoglobin A1C down in just 2 weeks, and significant 75% improvement in insulin sensitivity in that short of time period. Here's a longer-term study, because people will say, well, that's great, but nobody can stay on these diets. This was actually done in Kuwait, and the Middle East in general has one of the highest rates of diabetes of any region in the world. I think 7 out of the 10 countries with the highest prevalence of diabetes are in the Middle East, so I think it's about 20% in Kuwait. Anyway, they fed obese type 2 diabetics a well-formulated ketogenic diet. Now, I don't use that term lightly because there's a lot of poorly formulated low-carb diets. But they actually embraced fat here. They gave them extra fat in the form of olive oil, and they kept carbs low. And they did that for a year and showed that many of these type 2 diabetics put their disease into remission. So they didn't just prevent type 2 diabetes in existing type 2 diabetics. They reversed it and kept it there for a year. And there are other studies as well. This is work done by Will Yancey and Eric Westman at Duke, showing a low carbohydrate ketogenic diet was effective in type 2 diabetics and getting them off medication. And there are plenty of case studies as well. This was a good friend and colleague who's a First Nations background, and they have a strong propensity to develop type 2 diabetes. In fact, it's well over half that population in Canada has type 2 diabetes. But he developed type 2 diabetes over a decade ago and sort of came to low carbohydrate diets on his own research and was able to promptly put his disease into remission and control it with a well-formulated low-carb diet. Now, he's profoundly insulin resistant, to such that if he brings his carbs back up even 10 grams or more a day from 40 to 50, he starts to lose control and he needs to go back on metformin and eventually insulin. But he's been able to keep his disease in remission now for over a decade with a well-formulated ketogenic diet. So, but you have to realize, traditionally in sports nutrition, athletes love their carbs, and carbs have been promoted as not just optimal, but necessary for good performance and recovery. And so in this community, the fact that there are many athletes who are sort of abandoning this traditional guidance to carb load and emphasize all these sports drinks and gels to a diet that's entirely the opposite, low in carbohydrates, is really fascinating. And to give you a sense of what's happening, this is Tim Olson, who competed in the Western States Endurance Run in 2012, and I had my lab group out there. We were trying to study these athletes, and he won that race in a record time. I don't know if you can see that. It's 14 hours and 46 minutes. He ran 100 miles. This is a trail run through the Sierra Nevada mountains. I think he was about 30 minutes ahead of the previous record. And he's a well-described low-carb athlete, very vocal about it. And here, he's not just competing, he's winning and setting records. And it wasn't an anomaly. He came back the following year and won again in 2013, just this last July. A little bit slower, but this was the second hottest race in their history. It was 108 degrees in some parts of the course. So absolutely phenomenal what these athletes do. And he's not the only low-carb athlete. In this last race, three out of the top six podium finishers in the men's and women's class were low-carb athletes. So there are many. In fact, they're growing larger all the time. This is Zach Bitter, who we've had an opportunity to study, who just set the American 100-mile track record. So they run 100 miles on a track. And he's a low-carb athlete. This is probably one of the greatest low-carb athletes of all time. He just set the 24-hour record, where you basically run as far as you can in 24 hours. He ran 172 miles. And it's not just runners. I'm contacted all the time by a range of athletes spanning almost all sports, but these are our top downhill skiers. Bodie Miller and Lindsey Vonn have both publicly stated they've restricted carbs. Marty Fish, probably our top-ranked U.S. tennis player, one of the top-ranked. I guess the L.A. Lakers have now switched to low-carb, too. This is Dwight Howard. I'm not sure exactly what type of low-carb diet, but there's been some articles written about that. This is the Norwegian soccer team, Stromgodset, who won the equivalent of our Super Bowl there. And their whole team is on a low-carb diet. And you know, it's not just myself interested in this and studying it. This is Tim Noakes, who is really a well-respected, prominent scientist from South Africa and physician who has most of his career been advocating high-carb diets. In fact, wrote a book that was considered the Bible for runners called The Lore of Running, where he touted the virtues of carbohydrate. But in the last 2 years, he's completely switched to now promoting a low-carbohydrate diet, in part because he has a strong history of type 2 diabetes running through his genes. And he's quite an accomplished runner himself, and despite all his running, could not control his type 2 diabetes. It was only through restriction of dietary carbohydrate that he was able to do that. And I have a tremendous respect. He's a very gracious person. And he's actually admitted he was wrong and apologized to all the readers of his book. And that is rare in science, for any scientist to apologize that they got something wrong. So anyway, let me show you, share a little bit of data, because a lot of this is anecdotal, and that's only, you know, you have to sort of take that with a grain of salt. So this is my current lab in Storrs, Connecticut, where my lab is not so famous, even though I'm buried in the basement here, but we are the center of the basketball universe, so we get some visibility through that. We're doing a very exciting study now. I think of all the hundreds of studies I've done, this by far has been the most enjoyable, where we're bringing in these ultra-endurance athletes into our lab. We're flying them from all over the country, in a couple cases all over the world. These are really the top ultra-runners who have switched to a low-carb diet, and we're basically putting them through a battery of tests, trying to understand what makes them tick. And I can't share a lot of information with you, but I do want to give you a little sort of preview of what these athletes look like. So we're comparing them to their sort of high-carb counterparts, and we've currently tested 9 low-carb athletes and 4 high-carb athletes on our way to 10 and 10. But you can see their age here, mid-30s, pretty lean guys, don't have a whole lot of body fat. High VO2 maxes, but not extraordinarily high. But these guys they're running races, triathlon and beyond. So marathon is too short for these guys. They have to be exercising for like 8, 10, 20, 30 hours. And we're taking them through a complex series of tests. We're pretty invasive. We're taking muscle biopsies, fat biopsies, administering isotopes. But the real crux of the testing is a 3-hour treadmill run that they do here, and we're measuring their metabolic fuel use and so forth. So here they are on the treadmill, and this amazes me because we just have them stare at this wall for 3 hours while they exercise, and then we cut them up with scalpels and stick needles in their legs and take muscle out, and they love it. And that's really the truth. So let me show you what their fuel use looks like. So this is not data from this study, but this is data from probably the best study out there that shows what the peak rate of fat oxidation is in athletes, in humans. And you can see here that this is their VO2 max here, their maximal aerobic capacity. And this is their peak fat burning in grams per minute during exercise. And you can see it's pretty scattered, but even the very best fat burners, these are, include elite athletes in this group of 300 plus people, is about 1 gram per minute, the very best here. Most of them are clustered around 0.5, 0.6. So I'll show you that this is the peak fat oxidation in 9 of those low-carb athletes that we've tested. You can see they're literally off the charts from this previous work. Here's the high-carb. They fit right in the scatter here. So we've got guys that are 50 to 80% higher rates of peak fat oxidation than what's traditionally thought in the literature to be the highest rates that humans can achieve. So we're, in many ways, going to rewrite textbooks here. Now here's their fuel use during 3 hours of exercise on that treadmill. So these are the high carb guys, and this is what you'd expect. They burn about half fat, half carbs. while they're exercising. These are the low carb. They are prodigious fat burners, such that about 90% of their fuel is coming from fat, and it's pretty stable across that 3 hours. And that really puts them at a huge advantage when they're out running for, you know, this Western States run takes 15, 16 hours in the guys who are winning. And it's hard to keep up with eating enough gels and sugar to keep up carbohydrate, because your glycogen's gone at that point. So the better you can burn fat, you're in a much better state than your high-carb counterparts. Okay, I guess in the time left, I wanted to reserve this time to talk about how do you create a low-carb diet. And I hope I've convinced you that the science is compelling. I mean, I've just scratched the surface, and you can sort of study this on your own if you're not convinced. But even so, you might be thinking, well, this is just too restrictive. I don't have the discipline, that this is just too much of a compromise, it's just not doable long term. And I want to convince you that that's probably not the case for most of you. In fact, I would argue, instead of being a restrictive diet, that it's actually a luxurious diet. But you have to understand how to construct it. So when you do it right, it can be very satisfying and pleasurable, and it contribute to quality of life. But here's what it looks like. It's very high in fat. So you can't do a well-formulated low-carb diet and have it low in fat too, because your protein's going to be too high. It's not going to be palatable or sustainable. So if you do the percentages, we're upwards of 70-75% of your calories coming from fat. And that takes a lot for people to get their head around sometimes, because we've been so just sort of brainwashed into thinking fat is bad. And it has to be moderate in protein too. And it's very low in carbs. We're talking under 50 grams a day if you want to be in ketosis. On average, that may vary from person to person. And here's where those carbs come from. So not a lot of room here for pasta and bread and cereals and starchy foods and sugary foods. But if you take a look at those types of foods that fall into those categories, you've actually got quite a bit of variety. So that's what I'll try to show you some pictures here to get you salivating a little bit. But one question that you inevitably get is, okay, how much do I have to restrict carbs? And you know, that's a somewhat of a difficult question, because there's not a straightforward answer that's across the board appropriate for everyone. You might define a level of carbs that allows you to be in ketosis. And again, that varies from person to person, so you should actually measure it. It could be a level of carbs below which all your signs and symptoms of metabolic syndrome or type 2 diabetes are put into remission. And that might be different from person to person. It could be a level of carbs below which you're converting them to fat. And we're developing some biomarkers that tell us pretty accurately that this process is occurring. So we're pretty close to having a commercially available diagnostic test that'll tell you this. And we have also a diagnostic test that's sensitive to carb-induced oxidative stress. So, you know, you have to sort of operationally define that, and I think it's best to have some objective measures to do it. Otherwise, you're kind of on your own to determine what level works for you. As far as protein, there's a lot of different sources of protein that you can get in your diet. And again, it's not a high protein diet. That's a huge misconception. I suppose it could be if you select foods to make it so, but that is not the best way to, in my opinion, formulate a ketogenic diet. First of all, protein's anti-ketogenic. So a lot of people who are restricting carbs very low but are not in ketosis, it's because of their protein's too high. So that does have to be moderate. It's not low protein, but it has to be, you know, somewhere in the range of 15 to 20% on a normal calorie diet, or in absolute terms, 1 to 1.5 grams per kilogram reference weight. Not if you're really overweight, you might overpredict based on actual weight. So fat. Now fat is where it gets a little more opportunity here for research, I think, to get this right. But you know, you have to make peace with fat. But then you also have to decide, more than how much fat you eat, is I think it's more important the quality of fat. So we know fat is broken into different classes based on their level of saturation. So you have saturated, monounsaturated, polyunsaturated fat. And the question is, which ones do you emphasize on a low-carb diet? Now, the essential fats are your polyunsaturated fats, which include the omega-6, omega-3. You hear a lot about fish oil and the importance of omega-3 fats. In the diets of typical Americans, we're way heavy on omega-6 compared to omega-3. And on average, we probably get about 10 times more omega-6 to omega-3, and we really need to bring that more into balance. But in the context of low carb now, where the majority of your energy is coming from fat, still the question is, which ones do you emphasize? In what proportions? Now, one way you might go about answering that question is to look at, what does the body prefer to store? Because from an evolutionary perspective, you would think the body would store the type of fat that it prefers to burn as fuel. So if you look at that, so if you take a fat biopsy out of people and measure the fatty acids that are there, here's what most adipose tissue fatty acids look like. That didn't actually come through very well. But the point here is that regardless of your diet, most people store the predominant type of fat is monounsaturated fat in their fat cells. So the body likes to burn monounsaturated fat, and saturated fat to some extent, whereas PUFAs are not really stored appreciably in fat cells. So what that translates into is that, and what we've sort of learned from our research, is that on a low carbohydrate diet, where the primary function of fat in the diet is for fuel, you want to emphasize saturates and monounsaturates as your primary fuel. PUFAs, although they're essential, the amount that you need to meet your requirements is about a teaspoon of oil per day. It's very low. It acts more like a vitamin or a mineral in terms of quantity for you to meet your essential requirements. And it turns out emphasizing PUFA is not very palatable. You can easily become nauseated by over-consuming PUFA. And moreover, the PUFA that you do consume, you want to try to have a better balance of omega-6 and omega-3. So what does this mean in terms of food? Well, it means to avoid the PUFA and emphasize the MUFA. You need to avoid these common sources of PUFA. So in this graph, the PUFA are the sort of tan bars here. So it's the safflower oil, the soybean oil, the corn oil, which these are pretty ubiquitous in our food system. They're the ones that are PUFA. They're the ones you don't want to emphasize on a low-carb diet. So coconut oil is good. Butter is good. Beef fat. Olive oil. Canola oil. And there is high oleic safflower oil, which is good. All those are low in PUFA. Now, the good news is if you're eating animal foods, and most other sources of fat are naturally low in PUFA. So you might be surprised to learn, for example, beef fat. If you have a nice steak, actually, most of the fat in that steak is monounsaturated fat, oleic acid. And that's the same fat that's in olive oil. So I'm going to wrap up here and just talk to you about the fact you shouldn't be concerned with saturated fat, because on a low-carb diet, your body burns the saturated fat. And that's what's important. It doesn't accumulate in your body. So I'm going to go through this quick, but here's the sound bite. You are what you save from what you eat. When you're on a low-carb diet and you just eat the fat with vegetables and butter or whatever, your body's burning that saturated fat. It's not accumulating, and it's not associated with harmful effects. So here's all the fat that you can enjoy. Now, see? It's luxurious, I told you. One other important point about a well-formulated low-carb diet is the minerals. And in particular, I'll just talk to you about salt. Normally, we're fearful of salt, too. So I'm saying on a low-carb diet, not only should you eat saturated fat, but you need to emphasize salt. And here's why. On a low-carb diet, you have low insulin levels. Low insulin changes the way the kidneys handle salt. So you excrete more salt on a ketogenic diet. And if you don't replace that salt, the body responds by excreting more, and you lose blood sodium as well as plasma volume. And that, in turn, causes a lot of the common side effects to ketogenic diets that people complain about, where you're tired, you're lethargic, you might get a migraine or headache, you're dizzy, maybe even tachycardia, high heart rate. And people blame it on the lack of carbs. But it's because your plasma volume's down, your blood circulation's down, and you can easily correct that by replacing it with some extra sodium. Now, if you don't, here's what happens. The body responds with a compensatory response, secretes aldosterone and renin and angiotensin, and it starts to waste potassium, and that causes other problems. So you can get into this these mineral imbalances, but it's all fixed by adding a gram or two of extra salt. So here's a diet, low in carbs. I don't think you'd feel like you're suffering if you had, you know, these meals. So again, I think this is doable. In fact, this is what our subjects tell us. Here's some more meals you can have. And I'm over time. So here's one of my favorite meals, crustless quiche, which you can do all sorts of different versions of. Put it in the fridge, it lasts for 3-4 days. Got plenty of leftovers. Here's what's happening with keto adaptation. It's fairly complex, but a lot of benefits here. And it's this concept of ketones as fuel, but also ketones as a signaling molecule that's having a lot of positive effects. And this is my last slide. And I think this is relevant for everyone in the room. So, you know, biochemically, ketones and ketogenic diets are mirroring many of the metabolic pathways that we've identified as being associated with caloric restriction and longevity. So I can't think of a better approach, a better way to go about achieving an anti-aging effect than to consume a ketogenic diet. And that's sort of my speculation, but that's what a lot of the basic science is leaning toward. So thank you for listening. Sorry I went over a bit. I'd be happy to take a few questions.
The numerical value, well, what is ideal for a ketone level?
What is the ideal level of ketones? Well, I don't think we know exactly what, you know, what level. My range that I gave you for nutritional ketosis is between 0.5 and, say, 3 or 4 millimolar. I don't know for sure if being at 3 or 4 is better than 1 to 2. I don't think those studies have been done. So it's hard for me to say with confidence that that's the case. But I do think being in that range offers a definite advantage in certain ways compared to being less than 0.5, where you're in a non-ketogenic state. Yeah.
With such an emphasis on fats in the diet, what is a gallbladder disease sufferer supposed to do?
What was the last part?
Gallbladder disease sufferer.
Oh, gallbladder disease. You know, it turns out many individuals who've had their gallbladder removed can tolerate a fairly high level of fat in the diet, although that probably needs to be determined on an individual basis. But we've had many patients who've had their gallbladders removed and can tolerate a ketogenic diet fine because they're still producing bile in their liver. They're just not storing it in the gallbladder, so they can still manage fairly sizable quantities of fat without any problems. Is that what you were?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, in the back. Yeah.
Hello.
I have two part question. Are you familiar with the paleo diet, and what is your opinion if you are?
Yes, of course, the paleo diet has experienced kind of a resurgence in interest. It's probably inaccurate to try and paint the paleo as one specific diet because people have differing opinions what that means. But in general, I sort of see it as a diet that people are advocating that is based on what our ancestors ate. But in general, I also tend to hear most of the paleo community does not embrace ketosis because they generally include things like sweet potatoes, and they avoid dairy because of their belief that's what our ancestors did, which I don't really agree with. That to sort of think that our ancestors did not go through periods of being in ketosis would be inaccurate, and that ignoring the tremendous research on ketones would be a mistake. So I think in general the paleo diets can be very helpful for a lot of people because it's getting rid of a lot of the problem foods that are sugars and starches. So it is a low carb diet, but it's not low enough in general to induce ketosis. So you may not be getting the full spectrum of benefits because you're allowing enough carbs to prevent that metabolic state. So hard here. I'll let you pick.
If we are interested, where would we find suggested menus and references?
I was a co-author on the latest version of the Atkins book, which is called The New Atkins for a New You. It's published in 2010, I believe, 2009. And it was written by two colleagues and myself. And it's, I think, very, it's a very good book. It has a lot of practical information, including recipes and menus. But it's written at a pretty low level in terms of the science. So if you just want a book that's sort of a handheld guide to follow the diet, I think that's one of the better books out there. And I'm not getting any huge royalties on that. I might make a penny per book. So that would be probably my recommendation on a practical level.
We have time for one last question.
Yeah, I wonder if you would comment on the book, The Grain Brain.
Yeah, I haven't read the book, so I'm afraid I have to, reserve judgment on commenting on the book, so I'm not familiar with the details.
It's Grain Brain. I forget the name of the doctor that wrote it. Perlmutter.
Yeah, I'm sorry, I haven't read the book, so I can't comment. I'll have to put it on my reading list. Thank you.
Let's thank our speaker one more time.